وهل أتاك حديث موسى إذ رأى نارا فقال لأهلهم كثوا إني آنست نارا لعلي آتيكم منها بقبس أو أجد على النار هدى.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وما بينهما وما تحت الثرى. صدق الله العظيم. So that takes us into the fourth verse of Surah Taha. In the previous segment, I had briefly translated this verse. In essence, the Almighty says to us in this verse of the Quran that Tanzil, Nazzala Yunazzilu Tanzil, this is a gradual revelation. It's a gradual revelation, and that's incorporated in the expression of Tanzil. So you have Inna Anzalnahu, there's Inzal, and there's Tanzil. And one of the objections that the infidels had leveled against the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was that the gradual revelation is suggestive of the fact that the Quran is fabricated. But that's a blatant lie. That's a blatant lie, and there's no evidence to support the fact that because the revelation was gradual, it was fabricated. In the 19 Juz in Surah Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this baseless accusation of the infidels against the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, and the disbelievers said, لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدًا. Why was the Quran not revealed to him once in its entirety, at one given time? And Ibn Kathir has written extensively under the wisdoms of the gradual revelation. كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا. So Allah said, we revealed it gradually. Every time they opposed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a fresh revelation which would comfort him, which would console him, which would give him strength, which would give him encouragement, motivation, etc. Tanzil, it's revelation. Mimman, from the being. خَلَقَ الْأَرْضِ, who created the earth. We unfortunately walk on this earth, but rarely do we think and pause and marvel at this creation of the Almighty that He has created. Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawatin wa min al-ardi mithlahun. Allah says He created the seven skies and similar to that from the earth. So this is the verse of the Quran that speaks about the seven earths. Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawatin wa min al-ardi mithlahun. Alam naj'al al-ardha kifata. Just like Allah invites us in the Quran to marvel at the heavens bighayri amad, that the skies are without any pillars. فَارْجِعِ الْبَصَرِ, look at the heavens. كَرَّتَيْن, repeatedly. يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِئًا وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ. Your gaze will return to you exhausted, defeated, حَسِير, حَال, tired, exhausted. Why? Because the creation of Allah is flawless, it's faultless, it's blemishless, it's impeccable. There is no defect in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتْ أَيْ عَدَمِ تَنَاسُبْ. There's no inconsistency in the creation of the Almighty Allah. In everything that He creates is perfect. سُنْعَ اللَّهِ الَّذِي أَتْقَنَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Likewise, look at the earth that we inhabit, the earth on which we walk. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ كِفَاتًا أَحْيَاءً وَأَمْوَاتًا. Look at this earth. The belly of the earth houses your disease, while the back of the earth accommodates your living. So this is a revelation from this mighty being who created the earth and the elevated skies. وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَىٰ. In the authentic narrations, and in fact there's a verse of the Quran, I just have a flash of it, the 25th juz, Surah Shura, the chapter on mutual consultation. Allah says, تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ, that the skies are on the verge of splitting. And many scholars say that the reason of this is because of the colossal weight of the malaika prostrating before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah. Ma fiha mawdi'u arba' asabi' illa wa malakun wadi'un jabhatahu sajidan lillah. That there isn't the gap of four fingers, but that there's an angel prostrating before the Almighty. So there are the heavens, and then there are the malaika in the heavens, and then there is the earth, and then Allah has qaddara fiha aqwataha. Qaddara fiha aqwataha. Allah has kept in the treasures of the earth, beneath the earth, He has kept your food and your sustenance. And then Allah speaks about this in the entire creation of the heavens and the earth, how it happened over 6 days. قُلْ أَيْنَّكُمْ لَتَكْفُرُونَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَ الْأَرْضِ. Anyway, in this verse, that is the fourth verse of Surah Taha, out of the 135 verses of this chapter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that this is revelation from the being who created the earth and the lofty skies, the elevated skies. Who is this being? Ar-Rahman, ala al-arsh istawa. This is Rahman who settled on the throne. So that's a verbatim translation. And this ayah is one of the verses amongst the many verses of the Quran, the meaning of which is vague and ambiguous. Vague and ambiguous. But before I expound on understanding what the scholars have told us in the context of this ayah and the likes of this ayah, let's just pause for a moment on the word Rahman. Rahman. Oh, that gives us so much affection. Ar-Rahman, the most kind, the most merciful. Allah commences Surah Fatiha, the first chapter. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. All praise belongs to Allah, right? All comes from the word istighraq on the five types of Alif Lam that you have. One is istighraq, which means all the types of praise. Belongs to the Almighty, the Lord of all the worlds. Ar-Rahman, the most kind, the most merciful. When Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu passed away, then Abdullah ibn Abbas seen him in a dream and he said, Oh Umar, tell me, how did you fare before Allah? And Umar ibn Khattab said, Laqitu Rabban Ra'ufa. I met a very, very kind and merciful Allah. And that's my message to you, my brother and my sister, in a world of anarchy, in a world of turmoil, in a world of turbulence, in a world of mayhem, and in a world of despondency, in a world of despondency, where people are becoming suicidal, people are becoming depressed, people are going into their own shell, people want to claim their lives. One of the talents of the devil is to mislead you. And this is what he does, and we ask Allah to protect us against his treacherous plots and against his cunning ways. وَاسْتَفْزِزْ مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ مِنْهُمْ بِصَوْتِكَ. In the 15 Jews in Surah Bani Israel, Allah told the devil, go and entice whomsoever you wish, بِصَوْتِكَ, with your voice, which could either mean the devilish indoctrination. So he comes and he whispers. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Muslim, the devil comes and he says, who created the sky? You say Allah. Who created the earth? You say Allah. Who created the mountain? You say Allah. Then the devil asks you, من خلق ربك? Then who created your Lord? Your answer to the creation and the formation of everything is one, and that's Allah. So the natural question, the devil comes and tells you, well, then who created Allah? The Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِذَا بَلَغَ, and this is the sawt, this is the voice of the devil, which I refer to, that is mentioned in the 15 juz of the Quran. وَاسْتَفْزِزْ مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ. Go and entice, مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ, whomsoever you can do so to. Be sawtik, with your voice. Either it refers to this devilish whisper, or then music and all immoral voices and sounds. So the Prophet ﷺ says, when the devil comes and injects and whispers and indoctrinates, and he asks you the question, who created your Lord? فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. Then seek refuge in Allah. وَلْيَنْتَهِ. And desist, back off. Now, the Shari'een of the Hadith, those who commentate on Hadith, they ask a very pertinent question at this juncture. What does it mean? Desist from the thought? Well, if that is what is implied, then desisting from the thought is outside our control. Because I don't bring about these thoughts come about. So, and the Quran says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah will not task a soul beyond his or her ability. So what is meant by desisting? I didn't bring these thoughts, how can I desist? So the scholars say, وَلْيَنْتَهِ عَنِ الْإِلْتِفَاتِ إِلَى الْوَسْوَسَ. It means desist from focusing on these thoughts, and that's within your reach. So the devil will come and whisper, but don't focus, don't magnify, don't give it prominence, don't give it importance. Just shun it, ignore it, and it will wither and dwindle and fade away, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. So that is one talent of the devil, and he's caused havoc in the world. We can see how people just, you know, succumb and surrender, and we ask Allah to protect us. We cannot claim nobility or piety. My word, I have a flash of an ayah that I was reading in the tafsir, in which Allah speaks in the 13 Juz in Surah Ibrahim. Allah speaks about the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. And remember the time, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. And remember the time when the Prophet Abraham said, oh my Lord, make this land amin and safe and peaceful. And yes, Allah made Makkah the most peaceful of lands and most safe of lands. يُتَخَطَّفُ النَّاسُ مِنْ حَوْلِهِمْ. That around Makkah, people were being abducted, looted, killing, murder. But in Makkah, there was safety. Allah reminded the Meccans that you have two privileges amongst others. الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. That Allah removed your hunger and Allah fed you. يُجْبَى إِلَيْهِ ثَمَرَاتُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ رِزْقًا مِنْ لَدُنَّا. I just have a flash of this ayah in the 20th juz in Surah Qasas. Allah says that the fruit is brought into Makkah from outside places. الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ. Allah removed your hunger. وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. And Allah gave you safety against fear. That is why in this verse of the 14th juz in Surah An-Nahl, most scholars say the reference here is of Makkah. وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً مُطْمَئِنَّةً يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ. And Allah gives the parable and the example of a community and a locality and a nation. كانت آمنة, that were living in safety. مطمئنة, they did not fear any challenges. يأتيها رزقها رغدا من كل مكان. يأتيها رزقها رغدا من كل مكان. Sustenance came to them in abundance. فكفرت بأنعم الله. فكفرت بأنعم الله. But they then disobeyed. They were ungrateful. فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ. Then Allah subjected them to the garment of hunger and fear. And the scholars say the amazing expression of libas. Allah didn't say hunger and fear. Allah said libas, the garment of hunger, the garb, the clothing, the dress of hunger. Just like you shroud your entire body, you cover in a like manner, they were then enveloped and gripped and seized by fear and hunger. So anyway, Ibrahim alayhi salam made this dua, and I said that it is only Allah that can protect us. He said, Rabbi ja'al hadha al-balada amina. Oh Allah, make this place safe. Wajnubni, and protect me, wabaniya, and my son, an na'bud al-asnam, from worshipping idols. It's mentioned in the tafsir. Hakim al-Ummah rahimahullah makes mention of this in Bayan al-Quran under Masail al-Suluk. That dalla ala anna al-anbiya lam ya'manu ala anfusihim. La ilaha illallah. So the Prophet Abraham is asking Allah, protect me and my son from idolatry. This ayah releases a hint that even the purest of the pure, the galaxy of anbiya, lam ya'manu ala anfusihim, they did not claim nobility or piety or safety, but they also humbled and beseeched the Almighty. Oh Allah, you protect us. فَكَيْفَ بِمَنْ يَتَقَلَّبُ كُلَّ آنٍ بَيْنَ النَّفْسِ وَالشَّيْطَانِ. If that's the supplication of the pure creation of Allah Ibrahim, then how about the individual, the regular, the common, the average, the fallible mortal, for whom fallibility is intrinsic to his anatomy, who is between the devil and the ego constantly. We're either in the grip or in the ploy or the temptation of our ego, or then it is shaitan. Kulla anin, every moment, every second. فَلَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدْ أَنْ يَغْتَرَّ بِكَمَالِهِ وَلَا بِحَالِهِ. Hence the ayah releases a sharp warning that no human should be proud or arrogant on his position, nobility or piety, because we learn even the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam were humble in their demeanor, begging Allah for protection. So anyway, That's, I was just to tie up with what I was saying and it digressed, but I trust it was objective because there were meaningful deductions from this rich lesson of the Quran and more particular this ayah and the subsequent deductions from it, is that the devil tries to mislead you and then he comes with the second weapon, and that's despondency. That's despondency. There's no hope for you. There's no chance for you. There's no grace for you. There's no clemency. As long as we are breathing, Allah will even pardon shirk, which is the most deplorable, despicable, detestable crime in the eyes of the Almighty. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. That if a person dies as a mushrik, then there's no hope, to the extent that Allah referred to the very narrative of the Prophet Abraham regarding his father. وَمَا كَانَ اسْتِغْفَارُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ لِأَبِيهِ إِلَّا عَمْ مَوْعِدَةٍ وَعَدَهَا إِيَّا. But as long as you are breathing, my brother, you are alive, my sister, Allah refers to himself as Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahman, he's merciful. وَاللَّهُ يَحْكُمْ لَا مُعَقِّبَ لِحُكْمِ. Allah pardons, or Allah decides, and nobody can override the authority of Allah. Let's go into the complexities, if you were to say so, and understanding the ambiguity of this ayah as the authentic scholars of tafsir convey and transmit to us. So just understand things in a little broad brush as a preamble to appreciating the ibham in this ayah and the mutashabihat, as this ayah is referred to as well. Allah says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like Allah. There is nothing like Allah, and no one is like Allah. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. Allah has no equal. Allah has no rival. Allah is free from location. Allah is free. Allah is munazzah عَنِ الْمَكَانِ. Allah is free from location. Hence, the scholars of tafsir tell us in the 9th juz, where Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ. Those that are by their Lord. By their Lord. What is meant inda by? So in the context of this ayah, Allama Nasafi writes in Madarik al-Tanzil, manzilatan la manzila. They are by their Lord in station, in rank, in position, and not in physical proximity, not in location, but rather in station. Manzilatan la manzila. So that being said, these are clear verses of the Quran that Allah is unique. Allah is above what you and I can understand or grasp or comprehend. Yet there are certain expressions in the Quran where Allah has referred to as face for himself. وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ. وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ. Literal translation, the face of Allah. Then Allah has referred to as hand. بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ. The hands of Allah are open, are wide. Because they accused Allah, wal-iyadhu billah, which was totally, blasphemous to make such a nasty and I don't even have the words to say how nasty that allegation was, to say, wal-iyadhu billah, that Allah's hands are tied up. So there's a verse that tells us nothing is like Allah, no one is like Allah, He's unique. Yet there are certain verses in which there are expressions of certain organs. Allah speaks about the day of Qiyamah, يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ. It's a verse of the 29 Jews. On the day of Qiyamah, when the shin will be revealed and unveiled and exposed. So I understand saq as my shin and my calf and my leg. But what is meant by the shin being exposed and revealed on the day of Qiyamah? يَدُ اللَّهِ فَوْقَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. Right? Allah says, Allah's hand is above their hand. So these are different verses of the Quran. How do we interpret it? And in this verse, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arshi istawa. Allah, the most kind, the most merciful, settled on the throne. Ala al-arshi istawa, ala, above, or can mean power and authority, etc. Arsh meaning throne. Istawa. Istawa has many meanings. Istawa, yastawi. Walamma balagha ashuddahu wastawa. Allah speaks about Sayyidina Musa and Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam with the same word as istawa. Allah used this word in the growing of a tree or a shrub that you plant and how it grows and it stands on its stem. كَزَرْعٍ أَخْرَجَ شَطْأَهُ فَآزَرَهُ فَاسْتَغْلَظَ فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِ. So fastawa has many meanings, but loosely translated here as that Rahman, the most merciful settled on the throne. Now, what is meant by this here? So we have two explorations to this by the authentic scholars. May Allah preserve them and those, you know, may Allah grant them the highest abodes. Our early scholars of the past, the mutaqaddimeen and the mutaakhirin, as we refer to. And in this regard, we knock the door of Imam Malik. We knock the door of Imam Malik. Now, who was Imam Malik? مَا بِتُّ لَيْلَ إِلَّا وَرَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ Imam Malik said, in addition to being this stalwart and this legend and this great son of Islam and this great scholar of hadith, he said, I did not retire to bed one day in my life, but that I seen the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So appreciate who Imam Malik is. Imam Malik said, Al-istiwa'u haqqun. The settling of Allah on his throne is a reality because Allah has described that in the Quran. But what do the scholars add on? Istawa ala al-arshi istiwa'an yaliqu bi sha'ni. Allah settled on his throne in a manner that befits his magnanimity. That's it. My brain's shut down. It's beyond my grasp, my scope, and beyond my comprehension. In a manner that befits his magnanimity. We don't have the capacity. We don't have the ability to comprehend it. وَكَيْفِيَّتُهُ مَجْهُولٌ The dynamics of this is unknown to us. كَيْفِيَّ How, when, what? We don't understand it. Unlike how humans, I'm sitting here, I'm in this place. This is how I was sitting, standing, moving, mobile or immobile, whatever it is, my movement, my activity, my gesture is known. It's visible. You can see it. Allah is above our comprehension. Allah settle on a throne in a manner that befits his majesty. So the dynamics of it is unknown to us. Well, imanu bihi wajib. To bring iman on this is mandatory. It's obligatory. It's compulsory. It's a text of the Quran. It's part of our teachings. Wassu'alu anhu haram. And to probe and pry and question, this is forbidden. Chapter close. Right? So this is it. We understand that in the third chapter of the Quran, in Surah Ali Imran, which comprises of 200 ayat, by the way, and it's a Madani chapter that was revealed post-revelation, and in the seventh verse, Allah speaks about this whole thing. هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ That Allah revealed the Quran. In it are clear verses, explicit verses, non-ambiguous verses. They are the mother of the Quran, the basis, the foundation. وَأُخَرُ مُتَشَابِهَاتٌ And then there are the verses which are vague, which are unclear. And then Allah says, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ Those in whose hearts there is deviation, يَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَ They opt to pursue the vague verses. They want to unpack the ambiguity. Whereas, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ The interpretation of that is only known to Allah. وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ Those that are thorough, those that are profound, those that are anchored, those that are erudite in knowledge, they say, كُلُّم مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا That both the clear and the vague verses are from Allah, and we accept everything from the Almighty. So that's just a brief and a synopsis and an overview to understanding the element or the aspect of mutashabihat. That being said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, it takes us into the next verse, and that is the sixth verse of Surah Taha. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا وَمَا تَحْتَ الثَّرَى You know, sometimes, just to touch on this, sometimes a person learns little Arabic and he thinks he's now skilled enough to venture and apply his mind. Lo and behold, the Quran, you could swim in it forever. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, on the word takhawuf, in the 14th juz, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about أَوْ يَأْخُذَهُمْ عَلَى التَّخَوُّفِ Allah says He can grip you while you're moving, or He can grip you with takhawuf. Now what is meant by takhawuf? Umar ibn Khattab, who was such a great companion of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was an Arab, whose mother tongue was Arabic, he gathered the Sahaba. He said, any one of you know what does takhawuf mean? And then someone from the Hudayl tribe said, he said, this is very exclusive to our tribe. And he said, we use this in the meaning of tanakkus, which means gradual. And then Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, support your claim that the word takhawuf, takhawuf like that means fear, right? But here it means tanakkus, that Allah can seize you by gradually taking away what He gave you. أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّا نَأْتِ الْأَرْضَ نَنْقُسُهَا مِنْ أَطْرَافِهَا, that we're narrowing down the land upon them and we're taking it away from them. So this Sahabi from the Hudayl tribe supported his claim that the word takhawuf is used in the meaning of tanakkus by citing multiple abiyat, different extracts and stanzas of poetry. And then Umar radiallahu anhu said, okay, now I'm convinced that you have the correct understanding of this word. And yes, the meaning of this ayah is that Allah can gradually seize. Gradually Allah takes back, reclaims your faculties, reclaims your wealth, reclaims your assets, and you don't realize it over a period of time. Allah can withhold and reclaim everything. Anyway, we move on to the sixth verse of Surah Taha. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا وَمَا تَحْتَ الثَّرَى. To Allah belongs whatever is in the skies, وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ whatever is in the earth, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا whatever is between the heavens and the earth. In the cosmic world, in the universe, they talk of the space, they talk of the whole, they talk of matter. Allah speaks about it, right? Today astronomers are talking of matter and whole and all these other terminologies. But Allah says the skies and whatever it has, the earth and whatever it contains, and that which is between the heavens and the earth, all belongs to Allah. Khalqan, milkan, tasarrufan. He created it, He owns it, and He has access to it. La ilaha illallah. Person has 2 acres, and adjacent to that, he has another 2 acres, and he's like, you know what, raving about it, and he is trumpeting himself. Yeah, this farm is mine, and the adjacent farm is mine, and I'm looking to purchase the farm across the road as well. Okay, so 5 acres, 6 acres, 10 acres. Allah says the world in its entirety, the skies, the earth, whatever is beneath and above it, all belongs to me. To the extent Allah uses the word thara, wama tahta thara, and that which is beneath the clay. So thara, the scholars say, at-turabul mablul, at-turabul mablul, that the clay that makes contact with water, deep down in the earth, that which touches the surface right at the bottom, which is making contact with water, right at the bottom, Allah says, wama tahta thara, what is below that also belongs to me, and what is above the skies also belongs to me, and what is beneath this, between the heavens and the skies belongs to me, and whatever is on the on this earth belongs to me. So anywhere and everywhere it belongs to me. وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا, and your Lord never forgets. لَا يَظِلُّ رَبِّي وَلَا يَنْسَى, your Allah never errs, nor does He forget in any way. This is the vastness of the kingdom of Allah. So we haven't yet commenced with the narrative and the tale of the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and that is to follow very soon, in the verses to come. But generally, this is the pattern and the rhythm. Allah introduces the Quran or the chapter or His magnanimity in the opening verses of any chapter. وَإِن تَجَهَرْ بِالْقَوْلِ فَإِنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ وَأَخْفَى, and that's the seventh verse of Surah Taha. And if you were to speak loudly, وَإِن تَجْهَرْ بِالْقَوْلِ فَإِنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ, then verily Allah knows the secret, and He knows that which is more concealed than the secret. So in this Allah speaks. So in the verse above, He spoke about the wus'at of His sultanate, the vastness of His empire. Now He speaks about the vastness of His knowledge. Whether you whisper or you scream, He knows sir. Sir, the scholar says, is a secret. It's a secret between me and my friend, or it's a secret between myself and my spouse. Akhfa is ismut tafdil, which means something of a greater noun. Something more hidden than a secret. And what is that? And the scholars say, you sit in, and as we would say, you just daydreaming, and 1,000 thoughts going through your mind. You're thinking of the past, you're in the present, you're in the future, you reminiscing some memories, you have a nostalgia of something. Something might be a bit of a sad moment, a poignant moment, or you're planning something of the future. There's so much, and then somebody say, the doorbell rings and says, what you thinking about? No, nothing, nothing. And these thoughts that were flushing through your, crossing your mind, you grapple to recall and register, because there was an influx of thoughts simultaneously. Allah says, I know that about you as well. So that's the vastness of the Almighty's knowledge. Whether you whisper or you scream, it is known to the Almighty. So my brother, my sister, your crisis is known to the Almighty. Your plight is known to the Almighty. Why lose the moment? Turn to Allah. He's listening to your plea. He's answering your call. He's responding to your cry. يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعَهُمْ إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مَا لَا يَرْضَى مِنَ الْقَوْلِ. May Allah make us amongst those people who can consciously, continuously, and perpetually worship Him, glorify Him, and supplicate Him. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ وَسَلِّمْ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَأَصْحَابِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.